السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his entire household and all his companions. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى bless every single one of them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us too. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, it is so beautiful to be going back to the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, living in the midst of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, listening to the occasions and incidents that occurred, and learning the verses that were actually revealed in order to give guidance and instruction regarding these incidents. This is something that is amazing, and it's a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This evening we are going to commence still with Surah An-Nisa, verse number 128. We all know that in marriage, we have disputes. It's impossible to have two people getting along 100%, thinking the same, understanding the same, liking the same things, disliking the same things. That is impossible. So it is obvious that part of our duty is to make sure that we reach out to our spouse, to make sure that we adjust in order to be able to live together, to make sure that we try and accommodate them. This is part of our duty. And this is why even with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have learnt that he has indeed been so kind to his spouses. He has gone out to resolve matters, and he has also encouraged every single one of us to resolve. And from this, we understand the verses of the Quran have instructed us regarding the stages of resolving marital discord. The first thing, when you have a problem, you need to get together and the two of you need to discuss the issue. There needs to be communication. You need to talk to one another. Do not be afraid to address matters. Do not be too shy to talk about what is hurting you and affecting you. Say it, but in a beautiful way. Choose the best words to talk. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us resolve our marital disputes, those who may be going through issues. If you still cannot get to a solution, then you will have to involve external people. The best thing to do is to involve one person from either side, a person from her family, a person from his family, and these two who will be respected. The Quran teaches us that you need to tell them to find a solution. So there is no point in going back and digging history and trying to see who was right and who was wrong, because then you're going to go into a battle. If both of you want to solve the problem, and you both have understood and declared that we want a resolution, we want to resolve, in that case, nothing will go wrong. You now have to chart the way forward. You now have to think of how I want to move forward. But if each one wants to go into a battle to decide who was right and wrong, that's not going to bring a solution. It might come up with a conclusion, but not a solution. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand the difference. To know who's right and wrong is no big deal sometimes, but to be able to move forward is the bigger deal. In fact, that is the deal. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us an understanding. And this is why Allah says,
وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ شِقَاقَ بَيْنِهِمَا فَبَعَثُوا حَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا إِنْ يُرِيدَا إِصْلَاحًا يُوَفِّقِ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا.
If there is fear of discord between the two, then there should be appointed one person from her side, one person from his side. And if both of them's intention is to find a solution, you will definitely find a solution. Allah will grant you the acceptance. But if one party is thinking that, you know what, I need to prove a point. And this is why, my brothers and sisters, when a problem is resolved and people say, okay, from now on, we are going to move forward, let's forget about the past and continue. As soon as we start living again, she or he happens to say, but you know what, you were wrong. And the whole problem starts again. The whole problem starts again. So we don't want to do that. Don't go back and say you were wrong, and the problem is solved, wasn't it? Well, now forget about what happened in the past. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us, because like I said, there is not a single marriage that doesn't have issues. The magnitude of issues differs from marriage to marriage. Sometimes it goes beyond the magnitude of being able to solve. So guess what Allah says?
وَإِن يَتَفَرَّقَ يُغْنِ اللَّهُ كُلًّا مِّن سَعَتِهِ.
If, as a last solution, you are going to separate, Allah will grant both of you goodness by His will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed great. It doesn't mean that marriage was broken so the parties are bad people. Allah can give the ex-wife a good husband, and Allah can give the ex-husband a good wife, and they can get along. So this is the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us. This verse, hadith muttafaq alayh, reported by Aisha radiallahu anha, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, obviously at his time revelation was coming down. There was a man who did not want his wife. She had children from him, or she may have had children from him, and he was not interested in her anymore because of some reason. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses to encourage her to find a solution. And that solution might be to try and offer some form of compensation in order to remain in the marriage. Because let's face facts, it's much more difficult for a woman to be divorced than a man. It's much more difficult for a woman who has children to be divorced than a man. Although sometimes that is the best way forward because of the disaster that was happening in the marriage. But it is much more difficult, so it can only be a last solution, a final resort. Nothing should be left, no stone unturned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses, وَإِنْ إِمْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ إِعْرَاضًا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَنْ يُصْلِحَا بَيْنَهُمَا صُلْحًا وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ وَأُحْضِرَتِ الْأَنفُسُ الشُّحُّ. These verses Allah says, if a woman is fearing from her husband, you know, that he is going to turn away from her or contempt, then it is better for her to find a solution. It is better for the two of them to come to a resolution. For example, and we are taking the example mentioned in the hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, wherein he speaks of Sauda bint Zam'ah radiallahu anha, wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says she was the oldest, and Aisha radiallahu anha was the youngest. And what she did is, because she feared that perhaps Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam may divorce her. This was not on the cards, but she felt it in her heart because she was old and she needed a lot of care. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to look after her. And so she gave her night to Aisha radiallahu anha. She told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look, this is my right, but I want to give my right up. The right of spending the night with me, certain nights you can give them to Aisha radiallahu anha. This was a way of increasing the respect and perhaps even resolving a matter she felt may have occurred. This is foresightedness on her part. Although, like I said, it was never the intention of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do so, but perhaps the lesson was meant to come to us. For example, in the other narration, which is muttafaq alayh, also by Aisha radiallahu anha, the woman then chose, she said, look, you don't need to owe me, you don't have to look after me to a certain extent, you won't have to spend X amount on me. So it becomes easier for the man to say, okay, you will remain my wife, I will have your children, I will still fulfill your rights, but you have dropped certain rights of yours to make it easy for me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. I think the prime point we take home is that make sure you have left no stone unturned in resolving your dispute. Do not just think of divorce. I remember a couple that split over the salad on the table and where it should be. And wallahi, that was so embarrassing. And today, you and I know that people get married. The question that is being asked is, are they still married? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Then another incident reported in Tafsir al-Tabari, the riwayah is known as riwayah to Suddi. Those who are familiar with hadith would know that some of these narrations, some of these scholars have spoken about their correctness and accuracy. But inshallah, we will make mention of this because it is on point when it comes to this particular verse. Verse number 135 of Surah An-Nisa. A poor man had a dispute with a wealthy man, and the Prophet ﷺ was inclining towards the story of the poor man. Let's stop there for a minute. When you see two people arguing, one man has a big beard and the other one is clean shaven, naturally, someone might think that, you know, perhaps the guy with the big beard is religious, he wouldn't be lying. How do you know? He could have kept that beard in order to lie. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. I know of a man, and this is no joke, I know of a man who told me, the reason I've kept a beard is because people trust businessmen with beards. If that is the case, it's not the sunnah to do that. You are cheating, you are deceiving, you are insulting. Do not do that. But this is a lesson for us. When a poor man is arguing with a wealthy man, you do not know who is right and who is wrong. You do not. You have to listen to both sides. You have to make sure you've understood. Yes, if you want to give advice to one party, then you may. I give you an example. People come to me and say, you know, this person did this and this and this and this. I may not believe the story, but they ask me, what is your advice? I might give them advice without judging. So I didn't say that this person was wrong, but I can say, look, my brother, I suggest you resolve it in this way and this way and this way. Perhaps bring them forth. Perhaps let's come together. Let's sit together. Nothing wrong in giving advice. But to pass a judgment is what is wrong. When you've passed a declaration, that's it. You didn't even give the other party a chance, no matter how unruly they were. To be honest, if a drunkard has a debate with a person who is sober, it does not necessarily mean that the person who is sober is always right. No. Sometimes it could be that he might have taken the right of a drunk man while that person was drunk. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand the justice system in Islam. His sin of his drinking is separate from the matter at hand. So, before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could pass a ruling, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses.
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ
O you who believe, stand up firm for justice, bearing witness for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ
Even if it is against yourselves, stand firm, be honest. Bear witness against yourself or your parents or your relatives. It does not mean that because that is your family, they are right. If they are wrong, they are wrong. It's over. The story is closed. You do not take the sides of blood or color or wealth. No, you take the side of what is right. That is a Muslim. That is a believer. Then Allah says,
إِن يَكُنْ غَنِيًّا أَوْ فَقِيرًا فَاللَّهُ أَوْلَى بِهِمَا
Whether they are wealthy or poor, Allah comes before them. Don't think, okay, if I side with the wealthy man, perhaps he might just give me 20,000 when we finish with this whole thing. If that's the case, you've lost. What is right is that Allah comes first. Even if the people are upset with you, they stop talking to you. It's happened to us. It's happened to me. Where sometimes people call me to resolve a matter. When I've gone in, I find that they were wrong and the party that they called me against was right. And these people say, but we called you to this issue. I say, that's got nothing to do with who was right and who was wrong. You called me here, but you are wrong. Then they stop talking for the rest of their lives or for a long, long time, thinking that you usurped their wealth. No, justice is justice, come what may. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. What a beautiful lesson. Then we have the next surah, Surah Al-Ma'idah. Sometimes we get angry with people, again the matter of justice. Because I'm upset with you, I just say, look, that man is crazy. Because I've had one problem with you, I start thinking that everything comes from you. All the problems come from this man. So one day you might have driven a little bit recklessly. The next day I see a man driving recklessly or a car flying. I think to myself, must have been that guy. May Allah forgive us. But this is the attitude we have. That sometimes we just think, perhaps, you know, because of what happened, now I'm going to pass a judgment based on that. Allah says, no. Even if you've had a problem with someone, make sure you are just. Even if you dislike someone, make sure you are just. If I don't like you, but you are right regarding something, so you are right. It doesn't mean because I don't like you, that means you're definitely wrong. I must side against you and make sure that I push your nose into the soil, as they say in the Arabic language. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So, in Tafsir al-Tabari, reported by Ibn Abi Hatim, according to the narration of Zayd ibn Aslam radiallahu anhu, he says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Hudaybiyah with the companions. And you know, they went for Umrah and the mushrikeen blocked them. They stopped them and told them, go back, you come back next year. So they were quite upset. So while they were in Hudaybiyah, a group of mushrikeen from elsewhere happened to come for Umrah and they were sailing through. So these people, the mushriks of Makkah, stopped us and told us, you're not allowed in. But when the other mushriks who were going in, They're allowing them and saying, okay, you guys can come in. So some of the companions said, no, let us stop them and block them the same way that we were blocked. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses.
وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ أَن صَدُّوكُمْ عَنِ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ أَن تَعْتَدُوا.
Allah says, do not let the fact that you hate these people because they have blocked you from the haram, they have blocked you from making umrah, that you must now go and block someone else from making umrah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. It reminds me of walking through the customs when you arrive and you know your friend has got some items that he needs to declare. The customs stopped you and they're searching everything and that friend is sailing through. It would be unfair for you to say, hey, search that guy there. Why? Why do you want to pick on him? Let him sail through, mashallah. They stopped you. It's between you and them now. Let them open your bags and search. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. It's just an example that came to my mind right now. But it fits in here because the mushrikeen had stopped the muslimin. And the muslimin, some of them thought, why are they allowing those guys through? Let them also be stopped. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Look at the beautiful wisdom. Allah says, don't do that. Don't stop others. You were blocked, never mind, let them carry on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and may we learn to love one another for His sake. Ameen. Another beautiful verse is the verse of Tayammum. This has a beautiful story. You know, when we're making wudu, we need water. When there is no water, what do? We are taught as a gift to do Tayammum, which means you take some dust and your hands and your face are wiped. And you would arrive at the same level of purity as wudu would make you arrive upon. So basically, how did this come about? And what is the story behind it? And where's the verse? Very interesting. Verse number 6 of Surah Al-Ma'idah and verse number 43 of Surah An-Nisa. They are quite similar, these two verses. So hadith muttafaq alayh, according to Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, we were coming back with the army once with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and I was with him and I lost a necklace. She lost a necklace more than once, but this was once. And she says, I wanted to look for it, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped the whole army. And my camel sat down. And I jumped off. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions began to look for the necklace. And they looked for it and the companions were still looking for it. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was tired. So he decided to lie or put his head onto my lap and go to sleep. So he put his head on the lap of Aisha radiallahu anha and he went to sleep. Stop for a moment. Subhanallah, look at that. Sleeping on the lap of his wife. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us fulfill this sunnah. And it's the month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiply our reward. My brothers and sisters, a lot of us think that, oh, learning romance, perhaps, if you're a good Muslim, you should be a dry person. Go and read the history of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. You will be so surprised by what you see, how he ate, how he drank, how he made his wives blush, how he kissed them, what he did, how he slept with them, how he slept on their laps, how even his father-in-law saw that this man is sleeping on the lap of my own daughter. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. My brothers and sisters, people are quick to think of different types of romance when it comes to haram. But with your own spouse, people don't think of anything. May Allah forgive us, really. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us upliftment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this incident had to occur because we were meant to be speaking about it. He was sleeping and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who is the father of Aisha radiallahu anha, the father-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best friend and at the same time the greatest of companions. He comes there and he sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's head on Aisha radiallahu anha's lap and he had heard some of the companions say, look, Aisha radiallahu anha, she stopped us to look for her necklace. We don't have wudu and there is no water to make wudu. Now what are we going to do? So he poked his daughter. He had to do it carefully because he didn't want to disturb the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, how can you stop us here? The people don't have wudu and there is no water to make wudu. And you want to look for your necklace here. Anyway, she said, I didn't move because if I moved a bit and I tried to retaliate, I would have disturbed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I kept quiet. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam slept and he got up in the morning. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Imagine what dedication of a wife sitting there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Now we need to say something about the wives. Perhaps they wouldn't have such patience with us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them bear a little bit of patience. Ameen. They probably tell us, hey, you sleep that way, I'm going to sleep. So, amazingly, something very unique happened. The Prophet ﷺ got up and he was looking for water because he had to. He needed the water for ablution. And he found there was no water. And verses were revealed. What was the verse? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the long verse, verse number 6 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, as well as verse number 43 of Surah Al-Nisa.
فَلَمْ تَجِدُوا مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا صَعِيدًا طَيِّبًا فَامْسَحُوا بِوُجُوهِكُمْ وَأَيْدِيكُمْ.
And in Surah Al-Ma'idah it's وَأَيْدِيكُمْ مِنْ. Amazing. If you do not find water to make the ablution or the ghusl, then you use the dust to make tayammum, you will wipe your hands and your face with it, and you arrive at the same level of purity. Subhanallah.
Now the companion said, oh Abu Bakr, your family has brought a lot of barakah to us. This is not the first one. So much goodness has come to us through the blessings of what you and your family have done.
Look at how these beautiful blessings came in. Today we learn tayammum, and every one of us should know it. Although it doesn't happen often, it may never happen in some of our lives. We are fortunate to be living in Midrand, mashallah.
So Allah has blessed us in a million and one ways. Now guess how the story ends? In the most beautiful way, you wouldn't imagine what I'm about to say. When everything was over and their salah was fulfilled, and now they did not find the necklace and they decided to go, and the camel that had sat down, they got it up, the necklace was under there. Subhanallah, subhanallah. That means this whole incident only happened for us to learn about tayammum. Look at the beautiful verses of the Quran. Let's move on. Verse number 11 of the same surah, Surah Al-Ma'idah. It is narrated in Tafsir al-Tabari from Ikrimah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had come out with some of his companions, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali radiallahu anhum, Talha, and Abdurrahman ibn Auf. They went to Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, who was a Jewish man who really hated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But they had a discussion because there was some blood money that they had to talk about, and there was a meeting they had to have. So they went to Banu al-Nadir, the Jewish tribe, and they sat with, or they went into the gathering of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, and he welcomed them. And he told them, sit down, we feed you with something. And there was one of the other leaders, his name was Huyay ibn Akhtab. He was also one of the leaders. He looked at the Prophet ﷺ. They made sure the Prophet, peace be upon him, sat at a specific place. And he told his people, hey, this is the best you'll ever get. Go up to the top and throw a rock straight on this man and destroy him. So they went up and they got this rock. And they wanted to release it, but Allah held their hands back. Subhanallah. Allah held their hands back. And Jibreel alayhi salam came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and informed him to stand up and move. And he stood up and he moved, and the rock came down. So he was saved. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, verse number 11 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, O you who believe, اذكروا نعمة الله عليكم. Remember the favor of Allah upon you. Allah has favored you. إِذْ هَمَّ قَوْمٌ أَن يَبْسُطُوا إِلَيْكُمْ أَيْدِيَهُمْ فَكَفَّ أَيْدِيَهُمْ عَنْكُمْ. When the people intended to stretch their hands to harm you, and Allah held their hands back. Remember, that was a gift of Allah. Now I want to draw a lesson. Every one of us, there are so many times in our lives when Allah saves us. We use the term close shave, not to refer to Gillette, but to refer to incidents that have occurred in our lives. Close shave. We were about to be perhaps even killed according to us, but Allah saved us. And Allah says, hey, we're giving you a chance. How many people are alive and the doctors have given them 24 hours, 24 years later, they are still running the marathon. It's a fact. That's Allah. Allah says, hey, we favored you, man. How many who have had terminal diseases have come back, and the diseases are no longer terminal, they're gone. Out of the equation. Allahu Akbar. So let us think about it. It might just be a simple verse, but the lesson is so great that Allah has protected all of us from so much. And sometimes Allah prevents us from achieving what we want to achieve when He knows it's bad for us. He knows this is not good. You desperately want something, but Allah keeps on keeping it away from you. Sometimes it's just His gift. He knows. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. I remember a person who missed the flight completely, and that flight was involved in a crash.
That was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us and protect us. Let's move further. Verse number 33 of Surah Al-Ma'idah. Story narrated in Sunan Abi Dawood, Sunan An-Nasa'i, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. He says, there was a group of people from Urayna, or known as Ukal, the tribe. They were known as Al-Uraniyin. They came to Medina Munawwara. They entered the company of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they fell very, very sick. They fell ill. And there was cure for them, obviously, but in what? They were just not getting better. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that the cure has been sent down for you. What is it? Go to a certain place. You will find a farmer. You will find a shepherd. And he has a herd of camel. And go to that farmer and ask him for the urine of the camel and the milk of the camel and drink them both. So there was some cure in uric acid for them with milk. And this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ then, after having instructed them, released them. They went. When they got to the farmer, they saw this man is alone. He's got beautiful camel. So their intention changed. They became evil once again. When they saw we're going to get the camels that are the most expensive you could ever have, they killed off the man and took the camels. And message got to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and verses were revealed. What were the verses? The punishment for armed robbery in Islam. Now obviously there are different levels. One is the maximum punishment. You know, whenever there is a court case and the judge finds someone guilty, they serve them either the maximum punishment. So that's why they say if this person is found guilty, they can face up to 15 years. Then they get away with 1 year, I think it was. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. You know, don't you? Mashallah. So people get away. But the maximum sentence was supposed to have been 15 years, but they got away with something. So in the Sharia also, the issue of cutting hands is a maximum sentence. It doesn't mean you have to all the time. If the judge feels that there is evidence that would perhaps downsize, downgrade that, they can issue what is known as ta'zir, something lesser than the maximum punishment. So, but what is the maximum punishment? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse number 33,
إنما جزاء الذين يحاربون الله ورسوله ويسعون في الأرض فسادا أن يقتلوا أو يصلبوا أو تقطع أيديهم وأرجلهم من خلاف أو ينفوا من الأرض ذلك لهم خزي في الدنيا ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم.
Indeed, the recompense of the one who has engaged in حرابة. حرابة includes armed robbery. And you know, the highwaymen, people who waylay people and murder them and steal their property and so on. Those who fight Allah and His Rasul, those who engage in that which is extremely detrimental to humanity. Nowadays, some of the countries have drug trafficking on the list as well of this particular punishment. So either they are executed or they are crucified, or their hands or their feet will be amputated, either crossed or one, or they will be told to leave this land that they committed the crime in and go to another land for a specific period of time, literally exiled. So all these punishments are included. It is up to the judge to find which punishment is most befitting the particular crime that was committed. In this instance, the Prophet ﷺ penalized them with the maximum punishment. So they were executed and crucified, and they were penalized in a similar way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. The reason I made mention of this story here today, and there is another one perhaps coming up, we might say tomorrow, is because many people think the Sharia is barbaric. But to be honest, the Shari'i laws, yes, the maximum punishment is very, very harsh because it is a deterrent. To be honest, any country that has a high rate of crime, one of the prime reasons is because the punishment is so light that people weigh the act and the punishment and they tell themselves, look, I'm going to achieve 500 kilos of gold and I'm only going to get 5 years in prison and I might get away 5 months on good behavior. So I think it's worth it. Let me go. I'll do this and I'll do that and I'll commit murder and whatever. And you know what? A year down the line, I'll walk free. So what do? They weigh the two, and common logic will tell them it's cheaper for us to engage in the crime and go to jail. May Allah forgive us. The countries are guilty of having leniency, so much leniency that they put the whole public at risk of these criminals, of being attacked. So the Sharia says, no, make an example, a thorough example of the one who's a criminal, and you find the rest of them thinking, I'm not going to steal because this hand here, I don't want it to go. I don't want it to go. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So there are pros and cons. Take a look at the rates. The crime rates on the globe, the United States of America boasts the highest crime rate on earth. And yet they claim to be the country that has the most freedom. It's a pity we've got to mention it, but it's fact. I'm not creating tale. Go and see. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Their statistics are by the minute in terms of rape and murder. By the minute. May Allah protect us all. And then take other countries that are harsher in punishment and go and see how they are faring. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. I come from a country known as Zimbabwe, and mashallah, the law, to be honest with you, is quite strict. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. However, nothing compares with the beauty of this sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. It is indeed a beautiful deterrent. Tomorrow, inshallah, we will go through some of the other verses. I had prepared a few more, but I see that the time is up and I don't want to rush through these verses. They are very, very interesting and we take a lot home. My brothers and sisters, before I end for today, I want to say something very important. Whenever we are hearing these verses and the reasons of revelation, please take a moment to make sure you think about how it fits into your life. That is when you will be able to learn the lesson. If you are not going to think of how it fits in your life, you are actually wasting your time. So you need to ask yourself, have I had this issue? How can it fit in? Have I seen it happening? And subhanAllah, thank Allah and ask Allah's goodness. And perhaps a lot of these verses you will find, they will boost you in your life. May Allah forgive us all. Until we meet again, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wa natubu ilayk. Wa natubu ilayk. Wa natubu ilayk.